Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Every year when Ramadan approaches, there are always two questions that will surface. One of them is about missed days from previous fasts of ladies, and also questions about, I have fasted the whole day, like 17 hours. Then there was only 5 minutes to Maghrib, and I went to the toilet just to get ready for Maghrib, and I found blood. Does that mean I have missed the whole entire 17 hours? How do I deal with that? When do I count Maghrib starts and that kind of questions? So that is the menstruation side. Then the other side is zakat. Someone might turn to you and says, look, I have saved this amount of money, and now the time for zakat has come. How do I know how much nisab do I pay? How much know what percentage and all that kind of stuff? And things get so complicated when people, for example, have properties. People have businesses, shops, malls, bonds, shares, gold, and all that kind of, and then the entire thing, the world never ever seems to find an answer to a religion that is simple. So here, I always tell people, the reason you ask these questions is because you are not getting the answer from the Qur'an. And they look at me kind of like, does the Qur'an have these kind of answers? And I would say, yes, it does. It is just you are reading the Qur'an wearing glasses. Those glasses are tainted by so many different factors that I will mention, inshallah, in a little bit. Okay? So, always bear in mind that whenever you are faced with any issues in Islam where you feel confusion, hardship, go back to the Quran, you will find it there. As I mentioned before, Muslims are the hugest consumers of religion on earth. They are taught every single day. They listen, they do everything, right? And again, it's the way they are taught that makes you really go crazy. You see, when you go to a college, you are taught a subject, any subject, okay? What you are also given is that you are encouraged to have homework, research paper, projects. All these are tools to help you grow in that subject. You are encouraged to freely research, explore, and make that knowledge your own so that you can use it later on in life. But the way Islam is taught is like someone walking in a minefield. If you drift 1 centimeter from what you are indoctrinated, well, it's doom all the way. You are no longer a true Muslim, or you are not of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, or you are an innovator. An innovator is a nice, weaker term to tell you are a kafir headed for eternity in hell fire. This is why you hardly ever find a Muslim who challenges what he, she is being taught without being judged and excluded from Islam. Okay? So this is why, again, we Muslims take whatever we are fed, word by word, blindly and indisputably, as an absolute truth. One of such beliefs is that menstruating women must not fast and they must not pray. And that when wealth reaches a certain amount and after a certain time, you pay 2.5% of it. Now, if I ask you what are the evidences, you will tell me, oh, there are so many scholars, they always mention the same evidences. Well, that is what, this is how the brain functions. If one lie gets told by 100 people, you start believing that it must be true. Otherwise, why would 100 people say that? Well, guess what? That's exactly what newspapers do. One man owns a chain of newspapers and he promotes the lie in all his newspapers, 5, 6, 7. And because you read it in so many newspapers, your brain starts thinking that it must be true. Now, I have a few questions for you, yeah? Have you ever taken time to actually go beyond what's being told to you? What about the evidences given to you? Have you ever questioned them? Have you taken the journey to dig deeper into their authenticity, even if they are Bukhari, Muslim, and what have you? Have you ever questioned the explanations given for the said evidences? Have you ever asked any other opinions on the issue? And most importantly, are these evidences that are given to you, divine, i.e. from the Qur'an, or human-made Bukhari, Muslim, Hadith, and that kind of sayings of the scholars and all that kind of stuff. In other words, does the evidences have a sustainable force behind them, that is the Qur'an, or that a man made hadith, as I said so many times, that were created, made up 250 years after the death of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A lady from the WhatsApp group asked this question. I wanted to know if a sister was on her monthly cycle and wasn't done after a week, then after how many days should she start praying and reciting? Now, this question should have been obvious. Ladies have been through this for their eternity. But it seems still, again, the retention is never there. Also, a gentleman asks a question in the group about the zakat, and he says, I've saved 5K in 2017, for example, yeah, and then 1 year later, he saved another 5K, 2018. Now he's asking, on which one should I pay zakat and things like that? Again, the question itself, and he says that he had asked about children. Do they have to pay some zakat for children? And some of them say, yes, you have to pay for them because you are their guardian. Others say you don't have to since they haven't reached maturity. And I don't know if he's talking here about money or the zakat al-fitr. If it's zakat al-fitr, that's a completely different ball game. Now, this talk will discuss just that, these two issues, the menstruation of ladies and the zakat. And these are, again, as I said, the most two pertinent questions when Ramadan comes, menstruation and zakat. In this talk, though, I will challenge the beliefs you always had. I will give you the other side of the coin, invite you to what Allah says about these two topics. Hasn't Allah said He made Islam very easy to practice? Hasn't Allah mentioned that Islam doesn't have contradictions? Sure He did, but question is, where do all these differences of opinions, contradictions, conflicts and head scratches come from? Well, let me tell you right now, the end of this talk will be totally different than what you are used to hearing. And this will make your life more enjoyable as a Muslim, and you will appreciate Islam far than ever before. Provided you listen to what I say, and you do your researches, reach a conclusion, follow that conclusion, and enjoy Islam. To do this, we will need few tools, intellectual tools that is. And those tools are going to help us look at these two topics from different angles. And our first intellectual tool is to understand that, how does Allah interact with humans? And this will lead us to speak about the types of revelations. Allah the Most High interacts with us on a daily basis, almost to every second of the day. Some of us pay attention to it, tons of us do not pay attention to that. Of course, Allah is not going to speak to you as you would speak to a friend, things like that, but He has different ways of communicating with you. But since we are speaking about messengers and things like that, we're going to see how Allah communicates with humans as from whatever aspect of lives they are. And who is better to answer this question than Allah Himself? Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِبَشَرٍ أَن يُكَلِّمَهُ اللَّهِ إِلَّا. It is not granted to any human being, and please pay attention to the any human being. It's not the believers, it's not this or that. It's any human beings that Allah should speak to him except through. And now Allah is going to mention to us the channels through which He talks to humans. Number one, وَحْيًا أَوْ مِنْ وَرَاءِ حِجَابٍ. Either a wahi, a sudden intuitive perception, or from behind a veil. And I will explain a little bit later what I mean by this. Number two, behind a veil. And then he says, أَوْ يُرْسِلَ رَسُولًا فَيُوحِيَ بِإِذْنِهِ مَا يَشَى. Or that he sends a messenger, and here is Jibreel alayhi salam, to reveal the commands, and by the command of Allah, whatever Allah wills, to the center, and these are the messengers usually. And then Allah says, "Innahu Aliyun Hakim," for Allah is highly exalted and wise. And this is in Surah Ash-Shura, from the ayah Surah 42, and the ayah is 51. Of course, the human and hadithic Islam says that revelation can take place more than what Allah mentioned, such as Jibril alayhi salam shapes into a human being, or that Allah comes to the messenger or in a dream, just like Ibrahim did alayhi salam, or. But Allah says, no, I communicate with you humans through three different channels. The number one channel, or the type of wahi revelation, so to speak, is it's a feeling that the person finds in themselves, such as did the mother of Musa alayhi salam when she gave birth to Musa and she was afraid about her son. And also from Maryam alayhi salam, when she received that wahi, the revelation from Allah, when she gave birth to Isa alayhi salam, Jesus, and she was coming back home and she was scared of what people would say to her, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her that wahi, that revelation, that if you see a human being, you tell them that I am today fasting, I do not talk to anybody. So this is a form of perception or revelation, so to speak. You and I, we call this gut's feeling, the sixth sense, and all that kind of stuff. You see, when you feel something ain't right, well, that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is communicating with you. Sometimes a mother lives in China and the kid lives, let's say, in Australia or whatever, the farthest part from China. And the mother feels that her child is sick or something like that, or you feel your mother is in Africa, wherever you are, like a distance, far distance, and you feel that the mother is sick or she feels you are sick, and guess what? And it turns out right. How did that happen? Well, it is Allah at work. So this is number one type of revelation. This type of revelation is also found in animals, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Qur'an, أَوْحَى إِلَى النَّحَلِ, he revealed to the bees. Some people say instinct or whatever, but at the end of the day, how the cat behaves, how the bee behaves, and all that kind of stuff is continuous input from Allah to the thousands of a second. And that's how mind-blowing it is. And I will cover this more, inshallah, when I talk about what has Allah written. Number two, or the second type of revelation, is that the divine revelation. Okay, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to a human being, but from behind a veil. And this is what exactly happened with Moses alayhi salam, where Allah spoke to him. And Allah mentioned this, as you saw in the previous ayah, that Allah doesn't talk to humans except to three. And then he gave us the explanation, the implementation of this law in the Qur'an, through the Qur'an. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam. You see, Musa saw the lit or the fiery bush. He went there, and then the voice of Allah came from that bush. Now, Allah didn't use his own voice, it's not that. But Allah created a voice, and that voice communicated what Allah wanted to say to Musa alayhi salam. Just like you, some people, they have disabilities, for example, yeah? I don't know, they can't speak, but the computer talks to them. You input something, the computer reads it to you. So the tree became the reader of whatever Allah wanted to say to Musa alayhi as-salam. And this is fully mentioned in the Qur'an. Now, Allah in the Qur'an says that He spoke to Musa truly. So here we have to understand, as I was explaining today, what we are hearing right now what you are hearing, either on YouTube or on your phone or your car, wherever you are hearing it, you hear my own voice. But my voice is not in your iPad or computer or phone. My voice doesn't exist. My voice is here with me. So how does my voice get to travel to you? Well, it's simple. As I talk in my mic, the microphone converts the waves of my voice into electrical pulses or signals. Those will travel through the cord to the computer. The computer converts them to digital data, 0, 1 and 1, 0 and all that kind of stuff. Now, when I save them, I do not save my voice. I save reference to the tone of my voice, reference to low, high pitches, and all that kind of stuff. You, when you download my file, you download the instruction to an already existing part or device in your phone that will translate that electrical pulse or the digital 0, 1 and things like that into a voice, and then you hear my voice. You see, I will explain later on how the whole thing, and it's mind-blowing how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works, and how things that were miracles before are actually today day-to-day things to us. We don't even think about them twice. Now, the third type of the divine revelation is done through Jibreel alayhi salam, and that is Gabriel, or other angels like those who visited Abraham alayhi salam when they were on their way to Lot to destroy the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. However, it is only Jibreel alayhi salam who brings the books from Allah, either the scriptures of Abraham, the Torah of Moses, the Injil of Jesus, or the Zabur of David, or the Qur'an. Only Jibreel, the Holy Spirit, does that. Any hadith that claims that other angels brought down the Qur'an is a lie. And you will hear this a lot when, for example, you read about Al-Fatiha, or that Al-Mu'awwidhatayn were brought to Rasulullah by a special angel that never came to earth, and a special door opened for the heavens, and that special angels came down with the special Fatiha. All these are big lies, even if it's in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, used by scholars to push a belief that they had in, and they put all these garnished titles around this hadith or that statement so that you take it without questioning. Okay? And here is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Jibreel alayhi salam being the only one who brings down the Quran. Why is this important? Why do I say all these things? Well, because part of me is really suffering. Because I spent a lot of time convincing you to believe in Al-Quran. To put the Quran as a priority. And this is a big problem. Normally this is a given fact. We don't dispute this at all. But the truth of the matter, Quran is never the first station we go to when we have an issue. Listen to what Allah says about Al-Quran and Jibreel. He says, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Speaking about the Quran, truly it, i.e. the Quran, is descending down of the Lord of the worlds. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ. The trustworthy spirit, i.e. Jibreel, brought it down, i.e. it's only Jibreel who brings down the Quran. عَلَى قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ. Upon your heart, so that you become of the warners. بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍ مُبِينٍ. In a clear Arabic tongue. And this is in Surah Al-Shu'ara, the Surah number 26, and the ayah from 192 to 195. As such, the story, as I said, that is held that a special messenger came, angels came and brought a special ayah, the Al-Fatiha, the Surah Al-Fatiha, is untrue. And also, the stories about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, the night journey, I've already covered some of this here and there, but all this story that you hear about the night journey and things like that, to Allah, I mean, okay, that what Rasulullah went to the seventh heaven, got the Salat, and all that kind of stuff, are purely untrue, believed or not, and the amount of contradictory and conflicting statements about this will make any court of law, even in a corrupt country, not be able to hold somebody responsible for a crime. A good sister from the group further asked, when we are talking this conversation, we're having a go at this conversation, she said something extremely important, and she says, if something is not in the Quran, can the Prophet add anything more than what's already in the Quran? Maybe his own personal habits and characteristics that made him a good person, an example, can they be made legislation? Like the issues of women's not fasting while going through her period, where did it all come from? This question, believe it or not, now it's me coming back to think, this question is the heart beating of all our miseries throughout centuries. Has Allah given full permission to the messenger to add at will what he sees fit in Islam? But the answer was already given by Allah. An answer that is so crystal clear that it hurts to see politics, power, kings and government scholars and school of thoughts and what have you alter its meanings and implications since the very, very, very days of Islam all was clear. But after the death of Rasulullah, things went south, and since then, hopefully from now on, inshallah, we start getting them up, but it's going to take some time. Here is what Allah says about this matter, and that the authority to do or add anything in Islam was never, ever given to the Messenger. Listen to this. تنزيل من رب العالمين. The Quran is a sent down scripture from the Lord of the worlds. ولو تقول علينا بعض الأقاويل. And if he ever were to make up some statements on our behalf. Now, please note, in your behalf is used when I speak good in your interest for some you. So I'm talking to you, I'm talking to somebody else in your behalf so that you get something good out of it. But on your behalf is used when speaking for someone else. So I go to somebody else and speak to them on your behalf. I relate to them what you say. So Allah says in the translation, and if he were to make up some statements on our behalf, i.e. Allah didn't say it, and the Prophet or the Messenger would say that Allah said it. How would Allah retaliate to that? How would then here it comes. لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينِ. We would have seized him, and the speech here is on Prophet Muhammad to Quraysh, and he's talking to the Arabs, because Quraysh went to the Messenger of Allah and told him, alter this, add this, do that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in other parts of the Quran, Rasulullah says to them, مَا كَانَ لِي أَنْ أُبَدِّلَ. It's not given to me that I should alter anything of the Quran. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here tells them what would happen to the Messenger should he ever play with the Quran or add on top of the Quran. Listen to this. Rasulullah was a right-handed man. For example, he did everything with his right hand, like me, like you, like a lot of people. Okay, being right-handed is the norm. Being left-handed is the exception. Okay, then Allah says, لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينِ. We would have seized him by the right hand, i.e. making him totally defenseless, because when you fight, a right-handed person would find a lot of punch, a lot of power in the right hand. Then Allah says, we will take him from the right hand with which he can defend himself. Then, ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينَ. Then severed his aorta. Picture that. Take a strong man, hold him by his strongest point, his right arm, his right hand, then slit his aorta brutally open. Watch the blood gush out. Then Allah says to them, فَمَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ عَنْهُ حَاجِزٍ. And none of you could ever have saved him from that fate. وَإِنَّهُ i.e. the Qur'an لَتَذْكِرَةٌ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And indeed the Qur'an is a reminder for the God fearing. Would Rasulullah ﷺ add something after Allah said this? Absolutely not. You see, the idea that the Messenger was given the authority to add to Islam at will, changing the status of things from halal to haram, Allah says it's halal in the Quran, the hadith says it's haram, and vice versa, freely at will, and that he, the Messenger, curses people that Allah didn't curse. If a woman touches her eyebrows, she's cursed. If a man wears this, he's cursed. And if you wear red or pink, you're cursed. And that he was given the same rights as Allah to prohibit things or unprohibit other things. If this is not shirk in the commands of Allah, I really don't know what is. Because Allah is the only one, and he said this many times in the Quran, that Allah is the only one who can give that authority. When you ask people, okay, where in the Quran does Allah say this, that we have to, that the Messenger can make external laws? Or where does Allah tell us to obey the Messenger outside the Quran unconditionally? All you have to do is qala Rasulullah. The Messenger said this. And nowadays people say, oh, it's Sunnah. And that's it. We take it as granted from Islam. Where does it say all that? Then you are faced with many texts, both from the Quran, as if the Quran isn't enough, then they would add hadith. And as if the Quran and hadith weren't enough, then sayings of scholars and views of the scholars are added. So they tell you the ayah, and then if they do, okay, 99% they won't. They start straight away with the hadith, and notice when people speak to you, ask them about anything, they will say, oh, the sunnah is this. We have become just like Christians. Christians, Jesus, 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 and we, sunnah, 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 sunnah. Anyhow, so now basically what you see happening these days is an Islam that is 99% based on the Messenger of Allah says, or this is or that is from the Sunnah, or is not from the Sunnah. As I said, just like Christians, 99% of Christianity is based on Jesus said and Jesus did. So what kind of obedience to the Messenger is wanted from us? Why I'm going through all this, my sisters and my brothers? Because I need to untangle certain wrong tangles, knots in your brain, in your heart, in your perception. Because you really, really need to start believing what the Qur'an tells you and tells you without anyone coming between you and the Qur'an. This is the ideal of what Allah wants. You see, Allah wants you to make dua direct to Him. Allah wants you to rely directly on Him. Allah wants you to ask Him to help you directly. So Allah wants you to do all, deal with all your businesses with Allah. Why would He let His book be explained to you through other humans? Allah wants you, and the Qur'an is beautifully designed and authored so that someone who doesn't understand Arabic at all can read it and get something out of it. A PhD doctor will read it and get something else. A math teacher reads the Quran, gets something. It's truly universal, uni-science-fankial book. Like everything, typical mind or every types of brains can interact with the Quran. So, what kind of obedience to the Messenger is wanted from us? To understand this crucial point, one needs to take the words from the mouth of the Qur'an and not from the mouths of humans. What does Allah Himself say or wants to say to us away from all external influences? Away from politics, away from kings, businesses, school of thoughts, customs, tribes, parents, schools, and what have you. Here is in my opinion, and how I live my life and have been living for years with this beautiful understanding, how the obedience of the Messenger must be. Before starting, it is essential to know that Allah never asked us to obey the Messenger independently or as a stand-alone human being. Allah never said, obey Muhammad or obey the Prophet, but always says, obey the Messenger. In that is already a huge clue. Because if we were to obey Muhammad, then we will obey even how he goes to the toilet, how he sleeps, how he does, because now it's the persona that we must obey. And this is extremely difficult because he's not living with us today. And if he says, obey the Prophet, then the words of Muhammad and the Prophets are comparable, parallel, 50-50 with the words of the Quran. And that sometimes, as is accepted, sadly, it's really hard to believe it. In the Salafi school of thoughts, and preached by both the Wahhabi or the Egyptian sheikhs, and also is mentioned, and that's where it all started, from the book of Al-Qurtubi, a great scholar that lived in Spain like 800 years or 900 years ago. What this man said, he said the biggest calamity that drove Muslims into the biggest wall of backwardness until eternity comes, unless we break away from this horrible habit. He said, hadith can render the meanings of the Quran void, and the hadith can take the place of the Quran instead. And I've heard this with my own ears preached on YouTube. I had few people listen to it, and not only a few days ago, I heard it again. This is a calamity beyond belief. That's why whenever you bring in evidence to a Salafi, he will tell you easily without any shame that, oh, this ayah has been abrogated or is no longer valid or whatever. So they gave a liberty to themselves to actually think of the Quran as they please. It's not like Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam left a book with this and that, what is still on of the Quran, what is still off. It's just as they like, really. But anyhow, so how must the Messenger of Allah be obeyed then? Well, to illustrate this, I will need to use an example that we all are familiar and can relate to or with. Let's assume you work in a big size international computer company. The general director has a secretary or PA, whatever you want to call them, and that person's job is to deliver the commands of this general director to the rest of the company, to the worldwide branches of that company. When the director communicates through his or her secretary a verbal order for the entire world to execute, well, guess what? It is all well known that if you obey the secretary, you obey the director. And if you disregard what the secretary tells you, then you would have disobeyed the director and you land yourself in hot waters and a lot of problems. Now, the obedience of the secretary takes place at the place of work and not anywhere else. Therefore, if you happen to see the secretary at the gym or in a market or some store or whatever, you are not expected to obey her commands because the company you work for has not included obeying that lady out of the working hours. Well, our obedience to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is exactly the same thing as the example I just gave you. You see, if Allah wanted to descend upon each and every human being a Qur'an, then the revelation would have ended until Judgment Day. But Allah, in His infinite wisdom, decided to send down the Qur'an upon one man, and then commanded that man, i.e. the messenger, to convey this Qur'an to those alive with him. And then when he died, it was the job of those alive, those who were alive with him, to actually do the same thing. The sunnah, the term sunnah in Islam, as is used in Al-Quran, in Arabic, if we say somebody sanna qanun means he decreed a law, he issued a law. So the sunnah of Rasulullah, so his practice of what he did was to convey the message of Quran to other people, and we should follow suit and do that exactly. This is why Rasulullah ﷺ called the Quraysh and everyone else to the Quran and never ever to himself as an individual. Even when he said, obey me, follow me, i.e. the secretary tells you, listen to me, what she's doing actually, she's just relaying the words of the general director. Our job is to just convey the Quran, not force people to act upon it or collectively as a nation, whatever, follow one understanding. And this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam exactly did. He knew he was just a tool. He was just the courier so that the Quran reaches as many people as possible. And he also knew he wasn't Allah's stick on earth to force people to follow the teachings of the Quran. This is why there were so many companions who disobeyed Allah. Some of them fornicated, others drank alcohol, others cheated, others abused usury. Other men were mean to their parents. Some were backbiters, hypocrites, and the list goes on. Have you ever thought as to why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam abolished his uncle's Al-Abbas interest or usury in year 10, in the last 90 days of his life, even though the prohibition of using interest was revealed in the second year after migration? That's a hefty 8 years difference. You ever question that? That's why Rasulullah was no marshal. He was not a sheriff. He did not wear a sheriff star above his heart and controlled the masses, because Allah didn't send him to carry that duty. He was just the messenger. His job was to enforce the teachings of the Quran. If someone kills, then he applies the laws of the Quran, the Italian law, which was in the Torah and the Injil, and so on and so forth, right? But he never, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wanted to document anything other than the Quran, because it was the only book of law that he understood, and so did his companions radiallahu anha. It's not like what was invented in the Wahhabi Salafism of Saudi Arabia, where they invented a conscious organization that has cancer at the heart of it, that forced people to do good and avoid evil. They call it Hayat al-Amr bil-Ma'ruf wal-Nahy al-Munkar, the organization that makes people do good. And Allah never sent a marshal, never sent people like that. But anyhow, so that is, when we follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah, we prioritize the Quran. Look at what Allah says to His Messenger. He tells him, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. So remind, for you are only a reminder, someone who gives reminds to people. لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرْ. For you have no authority over them or to control them. إِلَّا مَنْ تَوَلَّى وَكَفَرْ. But whomever turns away from that reminding, the Qur'an, and persists in disbelief, Allah didn't say to the messenger, kill him or do whatever he did. He told him, فَيُعَذِّبُهُ اللَّهُ الْعَذَابَ الْأَكْبَرِ. Then it is Allah who will inflict upon that person the most major punishment. And this is in Surah Al-Ghashiya 88, from Ayah 21 to 24. You see, the messenger's job, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is absolutely made clear. He only is a means to relate to us what was descended to us from our God. And he is not even a dictator over us, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he gave him the authority, if we steal, if we kill, things like that. Other than that, we are left to ourselves. And then Allah commands the messenger not to be a tyrant over people and leave what is the wrong that people do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear sisters and my brothers, to really accept the judgment that I'm going to tell you about women, menstruation in Ramadan and the payment of zakat, you need to understand that Islam was perfected and terminated before the messenger's death. And Allah made this very clear before the departure and dismissal of the messenger from his post. You see, Islam is completed. Islam had reached the point of perfection and needs nothing else for it to be perfect again. Allah has made this in such a clear way in Al-Quran. Unlike the ayat given to all past messengers of Allah, from Jesus to the Prophet. You see, when you look all the prophets from Adam alayhi salam to Jesus, all of them has signs, has what we call miracles. Jesus gave life to people, and Musa had stick and things like that. Okay, this is something really, really peculiar that we need to understand. If we want to understand the signs of Jesus, Musa, David, and so on and so forth, we need to go back in history. For that, the more we are far off from them signs, the less we know about them. Yet, for the final message, the Quran, the sign of Allah, the miracle of Rasulullah, the more we advance in time, the more we discover about the Quran. This is incredible. It really is a change in humanity's trajectory in this life. The more we are away from Musa and other messengers' miracles, the less we know about them. Yet, for Islam, the more we advance in time, the more we discover about Islam. Isn't this mind-blowing? Doesn't this make your mind like boil? Well, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, la ilaha illallah, about 90 days before the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah revealed such a beautiful ayah. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. Today, I have perfected for you your religion. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. And have completed my favors upon you. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينَ. And have approved for you al-Islam as designed in Al-Quran as your religion. Sadly, if you went to the books of tafsir, you will find scholars disagreeing on the meaning of this crystal clear ayah. It really, my cat can read this ayah and explain it to you. You don't need anybody to explain that ayah to you. But why did these scholars from Muawiyah and the Abbasi and all that kind of era, why did they disagree? Well, because this ayah gives no space for any external added texts to be added above the Quran. In other terms, hadith has no place with this ayah. Sayings of the scholars have no place with this ayah. But how can the government scholars of since 1400 years, how can they manipulate Islam to the advantage of other agendas? Let's dispute what's meant by crystal clear. This ayah is so crystal clear. And you know what they did? They took this ayah far off from what Allah meant, and hadith, sayings of the scholars, found their way into Islam. Not only found their ways into Islam, but they actually took precedence over the Qur'an. And this is why we are in the state we are in. 1400 years later, women still don't have no clue about menstruation, what the blood, things like that. And people have no idea about payments of zakat. People have no idea about salat, hajj, forget it. And so on and so forth. Because we have tampered with a totally complete, perfect religion, which is in Al-Quran. That's why I said before, what's in Al-Quran is Islam. Anything else is not. It's only what's in Al-Quran. Again, to understand why women, why this ruling about women fasting, I will take the hadith later on and explain and show you the ranking and all the evidence. But for now, I need you to understand something about the persona of Muhammad. This messenger, this man called Muhammad, son of Abdullah, this man has got two sides to him. He has the messenger, he has one side that is the messenger, and that's his job. Like you are maybe a nurse, you are maybe a police person, you are maybe you are, I don't know, a computer engineer, whatever, okay? You have, so when you are at work, you are called doctor, but you are a human being, you are, that's what you are. And this is exactly the persona of Muhammad. He's got two sides to him. He's got the job, and he's got who he is. His job description is messenger of Allah. He is the courier to bring to us what Allah wants to say to us. That's his job. And the other side is his humanity. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him. This is a very crucial, really, really very crucial, and also one of the chief ayat that they use to put the sunnah as a command from the Quran, when in fact it doesn't mean that at all. Listen to what Allah says. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ. And whenever we sent any messengers before you, they were no other than human beings. Beings. Except that to them we sent al-wahid, the revelation from heaven to earth. Then Allah says to Rasulullah and to us as well, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So ask the people of the dhikr. The people of the dhikr are the Jews, the Christian, the people who received the scriptures of Abraham. Anyone who received a book from heaven, that book is called dhikr. Then Allah says to Quraysh and to us and to everyone else, so ask the Jews and the Christians and everybody, did their messengers receive revelation from heaven? Were their messengers humans and things like that? Then they will answer yes. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, bil bayyinati wa zubur. Also we send them with clear signs and scriptures. And then this is the chief ayah that they use to prove that the sunnah equals the Quran. And then they say, wa anzalna ilayka dhikr. And just like we did with the previous messages, we also send down to you the dhikr, i.e. the recited Qur'an, what you hear with your ears, that's the dhikr. لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, to clarify to people. Allah did not say to explain, لِتَشْرَحْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, so that you explain to the believers. Allah told them that we have sent to you the recited Qur'an so that you have tools to enable you to clarify to people what their God wants from them. I.e. without Qur'an, you are a total ignorant. And that's what the Qur'an says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابِ. You never had any any idea about what faith was or what iman. So what did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam need to show people, to clarify to people? He needed the dhikr, the Qur'an. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يتبين للناس ما نزل إليهم. And that is so that you clarify to people what was revealed for them. What's revealed for us? It's that they believe in Allah and not commit fornication, not kill, and then Allah says, and then perhaps with your clarification, they will reflect on the Qur'an and go to guide us. Allah in this ayah never ever commanded anyone to ban the Qur'an for hadith. Never ever. So the messenger had his job cut for him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The other side, and Rasulullah understood this. That's why he never wrote a tafsir or commented. In the entirety of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he never spoke about more probably like 30 ayat, words here, words there, where people ask him. Otherwise, he would never ever tell the people, come here, I'm going to have a tafsir halaqa for you. I'm going to explain what Allah wants from you. No. He left people to the book of Allah because he was a courier. When you buy something from eBay, Amazon, or whatever, the courier brings to you what you order, obviously here, but normally what Allah sent to you. The other side to him is just being a pure mortal being, human. As a matter of fact, Muslims read without comprehension every Jummah, every Friday, Suratul Kahf. They want the results, right? They want the rewards. And at the end of it, the closing ayah of the whole entire surah states, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Say, I am only but a human being like you. But the difference between you and me is that يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ, that I have received the revelation from Allah. So you see, the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ understood his job. He was a human being, and his job was a messenger, a courier, to bring to us what Allah wants us to have, and that's what you have the Qur'an for, to understand it, implement it, and then on Judgment Day, Allah will judge us based on how we interacted with the Qur'an. This is why, again, the Prophet ﷺ never imposed on anyone his views or how he should understand the Qur'an, and he never left a tafsir commentaries or the meaning of the Qur'an, nothing at all. Muhammad fully understood his job description. It is the people who came after him, especially scholars, and especially those scholars from the time of Uthman and upwards. It is these people that played with his job description to serve other agendas. Agendas of the rulers, kings, then it spiraled to the school of thoughts, and that's what we got Islam from. And that is the sorry state we are in these days. The Prophet ﷺ understood from his interaction with the Holy Qur'an what the Qur'an so much wanted from him, and that's why he never gave his opinion. And because he never gave his opinion, what matters to us is what was mentioned in Al-Quran. Take for example the word cold. The word cold. Does it have one meaning, the word cold, C-O-L-D? It would seem so. But then again, when we look at it from different angles and different situations, the word cold can take so many different meanings. For example, our love went cold. I received a cold call from a marketing company. The room is cold. He gave me the cold shoulder. If he gets angry, keep him cold. She wore a cold blue dress. The phone line went cold. You get the idea. Therefore, when Allah gives a command to humanity, the application of that command is subjective and must be taken in the context of where in the topic it was mentioned. This is why Allah in the Qur'an made no more than 20 haram things. In the entire Qur'an, only about 20 things are haram. Everything else is halal. In fact, the Qur'an came to make our lives a lot easier than how they were before, from Musa and Jesus and all that kind of stuff. Now listen to this. Allah says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to us and to everyone who reads the Qur'an, مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى. We did not reveal the Qur'an to you to cause you distress. Or, we did not reveal the Qur'an to you to make you face hardship. And this is in Surah number 20, ayah number 2. Therefore, any distress you might experience in your life is not from the Qur'an. And the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam very well understood this. And as such, the text of the Qur'an is not bound to an era or place. It is free to all and for all people to break away from any shackles. Now let us, for example, take a very widely spread unconditional beliefs held by an almost entirety of the Muslim world. Muslim women menstruation and fasting in Ramadan. And towards the end I will also cover a zakat. Ask any Muslim, and if I ask you, man or woman, if a woman has her menstrual cycle, what can she do or don't? You will, just like anyone else, you will straight away answer, she cannot pray, nor can she fast. And if I say why, the answer will straight away jump, because the Messenger of Allah says, I told you our Islam is based on the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says. Then they mention the hadith that deals with this matter. That is, if they know the hadith, and you'll be surprised of how many of them are. Now, this is, especially if this answer is very insulting to women, like women they like in the brain and intelligence and the religion. The brain and intelligence is because they can't witness a man to two women. And in religion, when they have their menses, they don't pray and they don't fast. And that is a lack in their Islam. When in fact it is not, because they are still obeying Allah. It does not affect Islam at all. But anyhow, this is nonsense that is being spread and portrayed by school of thoughts and scholars and so on and so forth. Now, my dear sisters and my brothers, we must pay attention to a very crucial and dangerous matter. People seem to forget that what matters here is not the messenger, but rather the one who sent the messenger and the message itself. We have become worse than Christians. You see, Christians' entrance to paradise evolve around them believing that Jesus is Son of God and that Jesus came here to die for the sins, and you know the drill, okay? And we Muslims, apart from the Son of God, the rest, we are worse than Christians. We have replaced the Quran with the sayings of the messenger that were collected 250 years later. Go figure that. Go really try. Let me now take you 1,400 years ago at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ to understand this issue of menstruation. Over 14 centuries ago, a bunch of people went to the Messenger of Allah ﷺ and asked him about how to treat women while in their menstrual cycle. And this question was because some of the inhabitants of Al-Madinah, as you know, were three big tribes of Jews, Banu Qurayda, Banu Qaynuqa, and Banu Al-Nadir. And the Jews in their religion, they have this strange way in dealing with women who have their menstrual cycle. They consider the woman to be impure, and as such, anything that she touches, sits on, whatever, becomes impure. That's why they have women sit on pillows at dinners and all that. She carries a pillow with her wherever she goes, she sits on it and whatever it is. The Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was aware of that. Jews were all around town, as I said, and he dealt with them on a daily basis. He even received food from them, just as neighbors would share food and dishes with each other, except in England, but the rest of the world do that. So Muslims went to the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and asked him, Messenger of Allah, how should we deal with our menstruating women? Shall we treat them as the Jews do? Because the people of Al-Madinah used to regard the Jews as most learned in the scriptures. So they say, should we treat them as the Jews do or not? And since the messengers, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, did not have any authority to answer from himself, and because he did not have the answer to that question, unlike the thousands of hadith linked to him when he, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is very innocent from them, he could not answer them. And then what happened is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the master, the overlooker of al-Islam, revealed to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam what should the answer be, because that is how Allah wants this religion to roar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ, and they ask you about menstruation. say قل سبحان الله. This is why Rasulullah ﷺ cannot curse or add anything extra to Islam. Everything is by Allah, and Rasulullah ﷺ, as I said, is the messenger. Say, i.e. answer them, هو أذى. It is a harm. After all, it's a blood. And remember, Allah has prohibited, He made haram for us to eat blood, because blood is just pure harm to humans. And guess what? It is also a harm. And I will explain later on. And it is a harm. Therefore, sexually isolate yourselves or stay away from women in the menstruation. And then Allah explains what He really means and exactly what He means, and He goes, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوهُنَّ حَتَّى يَطْهُرْنَ, and do not sleep with them sexually till they are no longer menstruating, they are pure from the menstruation. The place of menstruation of the vagina of a woman, that part there, the inside, is clean. Why, Ya Allah, all this? Allah says, فَإِذَا تَطَهَرْنَ, and when they are no longer menstruating, فَأْتُوهُنَّ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَمَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ, then you may sleep with them sexually from where Allah specified. And this is one evidence of the prohibition of anal sex, because Allah orders us to penetrate women in their vagina, not in their on the back. And then Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ, certainly Allah loves those who repent to Him, and وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِرِينَ, and He loves those who clean themselves. Allah explained what menstruation was. It was a bad blood. That blood was about to make a human being. Then a woman, for that moment, that did not get pregnant, so the body gets to release all the chemical toxins and everything. As you all know, either you are female or male, a man's penis has got a hole where we pee from and things like that, and the head of the penis is extremely sensitive. If and when the man is aroused, the blood that gets to the penis is really concentrated. The body sends all the blood, the energy, to that part of the body so that the penis is erect. Now, when we are erect, the sensitivity of the penis is extremely high, and it is easy for a stretched skin to swallow of the environment. Now imagine the vagina of a woman full of harmful blood. That is really harm to us, the male, and also harm to the female themselves, because of the state of where they are in, the blood going back in and things like that. And then once we carry the diseases in us, later on when you sleep with your wife, you're gonna give her back that disease, and a lot of problems would occur at that moment there. So here is the Qur'an explicitly commands us to isolate ourselves from our wives when they have menses. The ayah is so clear that a blind person would be able to tell you what it means. You see, for you young guys who are not married, or maybe for the married men who still do not understand the haid, the menstruation, I'd like to say this, okay? The haid or the menstruation is the process in which a woman discharges blood and other materials from the lining of her uterus at intervals, as you know, lunar days of the month. Each woman has got a set date, okay? Until she reaches menopause. Once she reaches menopause, no more menstruation, end of that. But that blood comes out, and the orifice it comes out from are a source of hurt and harm. And for that, Allah commands the male gender who asked the question not to stimulate women sexually or penetrate them or get in all kinds of sexual misconduct. The sad thing is, as portrayed in the Islam of the Hadith, and the views of scholar, the first person to go against the Quran, the first person to ignore Allah's words, is none else than the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam personally. Any Muslim who has an atom weight of knowledge and piety would understand that as soon as the wife starts her menstruation, the husband would refrain and keep his distance from her with any sexual involvement, because Allah says, فَعَتَزِلُ النِّسَاءَ, i.e. isolate yourself from women sexually. The Jews took it to the far end, like completely isolate themselves from the woman. Now Allah says, no, you interact with the woman, you do whatever, except when it comes to sexually, keep away from yourself. Check this calamity out. And this hadith is in Al-Bukhari and other books of hadith. But I will just mention Al-Bukhari because it is considered by Salafists and everyone else who follows their views as the most authentic book after the Qur'an. What a lie, but hey. And I totally disagree with this statement, but just to mention it to show you why the Qur'an is completely ignored. You go to Al-Bukhari, you will find that our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, this hadith is attributed to Aisha. She said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يباشرني وأنا حائض. I.e. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to sexually approach me. Yubashiruni means al-bashar. Al-bashar means the skin. He used to, if I want to translate it literally, he used to apply his entire skin naked. Wa ana haid, i.e. when she has her menses, he would get naked with her and start having sex with her. This is, okay, sex without the penetration. Now the hadith in other hadith in al-Bukhari and other ones, they further explains that when she would have her menstruation, Rasulullah ﷺ would command her to get a bed sheet and threw it on her vagina, that part of the body, the midsection. And then he would do everything that a man would do, enjoy himself sexually, and that's it. And then he wakes and gets up and goes. My question is, why did he do that? Wasn't he man enough to hold himself for 4 or 5 days until his wife gets fully functional and then do it good? 2, when he fooled with her sexually, did he come? Did he ejaculate? Did she masturbate him? What happened? What happened to put Rasulullah ﷺ in such disgraceful position? Al-Quran says, "A'tazilu an-nisa," isolate yourself from women sexually. And the hadith tells you, nope. Rasulullah would command Aisha to throw a sheet on her midsection and then he would do everything except penetration. You see how the hadith makes the first person to disobey Allah is the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. La ilaha illallah. It's reached an hour. I need now to move on because we get into the crop of the talk about the women. And in the next part, inshallah, I'm going to speak about how Allah deals with the exceptions in Al-Quran. For example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala issues a ruling, and that ruling, there is a possibility that there are a bunch of people who cannot do that, then Allah excludes them. For example, when He says, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْرَجِ حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيدِ حَرَجٌ. When Allah sent the Muslims to fight the Romans who were approaching Al-Madinah to invade them, Allah told all Muslims in Al-Madinah to get ready to go to fight. And then He excluded 3 types. And He excluded the blind. There is no guilt upon the blind. The lame people who can't walk properly. And the other one who is sick and he can't go to fight. Then there is no guilt upon these people. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala authorizes everyone else to go to fight. In the next part, inshallah, I will speak about the exceptions, how Allah deals with them. And when Allah mentioned the fast, who did He exclude from the fast? He excluded 2 types, the traveler and the sick. But He didn't mention the menstruating woman. Where did Allah mention that? This, inshallah, will be in the next talk, part 2. Again, this is your brother, Abdus Salam Abu Hanif, and off to part 2, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.